I just wanted to remind you of something today. It's not the same kind of teaching, but the teaching is really in the testimony that you're going to hear. Trevor and Shannon had a vision to help all churches in Ontario and motivate them, say, it doesn't matter how big or small you are, if you believe in people, God will raise people up to do things in the world. And so we're now going to show you some clips of that. And I'm just going to read you, it was called Be Love, and it's in the process of doing it, and different video clips. We showed it in church, and here's what it means. It says, the heart of Be Love was to try to build a brand out of the action step of the Great Commission, which in our opinion was simply to be love to everyone you meet, no more complicated than that. The reason we did that video, and it was supposed to be a four-part series, is to try to clearly show that whether it takes a pastor, a youth pastor, volunteer youth worker, or parent who's consistently choosing to be love in the ordinary and sometimes less than ordinary circumstances that we live in every day, but they're acting for God in extraordinary ways, and God raises them up and uses them. That ordinary kids like us, exposed to the love of Jesus in such a consistent and tangible way from a young age, results in so many of us believing that we can do the impossible, the extraordinary things through Christ. So this was their vision. They're working on it. It's going to be out there. And we want to give you these clips again so you can be encouraged and tell people, I'm going to believe in you and God can use you.
Any pastor out there, any youth pastor out there who thinks you're in an insignificant city in an insignificant building with ordinary people in your youth group or church, you should see where this started. This was kind of everything. This was our church and our youth group and our school. This building was a lot of my life. Windows aren't even in.
Crazy. It's literally been like 20 years, man. I like what they've done with the landscaping. Don't get too close to the glass.
Holy.
Wow.
Whoa.
Man.
Look at this.
This is unreal. That was the sound booth. It looked like a DJ booth. Just spinning tapes up here. It's crazy.
The initial thought was to show everybody where it started and how ordinary it was. That the circumstances were not something that looked like they... There was no logical reason that you could go from this to where things are as a church. Coming back to this is a pretty remarkable gap to bridge. Holy jeez.
Thing up there, a little youth band action. So this is where I actually went to youth group as well.
It's all about you. I didn't go.
You were doing that after I remember this. Having stage fright, like performing any song, you know, on the stage, and just being around kids at this school who just loved you whether you could sing or not and encouraged you, you know, like, dude, get up there, do it again or whatever. And just that was kind of the culture that this church and the heart of it created. And I don't know how much of this I remember, but there was one about like, it's 1999, I'm dropping rhymes on drums. I started rocking auditoriums, the gymnasiums, getting dumb, taking my chances, trying to advance this style. Well, in the meanwhile, making it worth your while.
I ain't a teacher, because teachers are every teacher. Like everyday preacher. I remember that.
Yeah, it's been 30 years since I've been to that building. It was powerful, man. It's the best way I could put it. I still felt the anointing in that room, and there's something special about it.
This was like our whole world for like 10 plus years. It seemed a lot bigger than this at the time.
In really every way, it kind of changed everything. It was, you know, the beginning of our entire family's journey in faith. And what that even means, what it looks like, and the idea of a living God, you know? And, you know, that idea of like, wow, I can talk to God like I'm talking to Shan right now, you know? Just that was such new information to us.
We had an amazing amount of love and an amazing amount of God's anointing and Holy Spirit and all that stuff, but we had a very ordinary setup. like ordinary is maybe generous sometimes, but it was always extraordinary what was happening there, and that was because of Pastor Brian and his vision. He never got his eyes on the ordinary. He saw this very ordinary situation and always believed and breathed extraordinary into it.
Shane and I were both byproducts of being in that environment for a long time and being able to see love, you know, in order for that to translate into being able to be love.
I'm sure everyone's youth pastor seems a little weird. You probably don't get into youth ministry if you're just straight and narrow, but Rick was like so far left field. I've never met anyone like Rick.
Well, I was a policeman for 10 years, just about 10 years in Peterborough, Ontario, and I always liked helping youth. I started out, I was going to be a social worker. So one day it didn't work out so well as a social worker. They said, you need to become a policeman. You're a little too rough around the edges. So I said, okay, well, I'll try to be a policeman. Went and applied, and by the grace of God, we got a job being a police officer. And the more time I spent as a police officer, the more I recognized my heart for youth and young people.
Safest job in our city is a cop. Great holidays, great bonuses, great, you know, benefits. Nobody, once you're a cop or a fireman or an EMT in this city, you don't leave it. It's, you just ride it out. And he felt like he was supposed to leave and be a youth pastor.
So here's a guy that's 10 years as a police officer, family to support. There, his family thought he was nuts. You're giving up your police, are you kidding me? To do what?
We had a tiny little church and a tiny little youth group and there was nothing going on. So it wasn't like he was leaving for a sexy position. And he didn't really have a strong background of theology or anything.
Shannon's right. I didn't have a clue what I was doing. I was so scared to death to even share the word of God with kids. I wouldn't even step on the platform. It's just like, I don't know. But God gave me a word of scripture, said, you know, 2 Timothy 2:2, these whatsoever you've heard among many men, you know, transmit to other faithful men and women that they would be able to teach also. So it's like, God gave me the word, you only need to know what I've told you, this one thing today. Share that with those around you and let that be light and life and love to them. And that's all you need, is that one thing today. And that was what liberated me. I just, we'll give it a try.
He just created this culture where, man, there was such a love for one another. It didn't matter what family, what background, what class you came from. It didn't matter. None of that mattered.
We went from this nothing little youth group that not one of my friends would ever come to who didn't go to church, to having these crazy, like, Halloween parties where you'd have hundreds of kids from around the city, and you're doing three-man slingshots with pumpkins on targets on the side of a building, and you're doing cow tongue relays, and like, it was insane. But he was just one of those guys that was like, we're in. How are we gonna do it? I don't know. As soon as he knew he was supposed to do it, he'd say yes and start walking. He wouldn't say, how are we gonna do it? Wait, what are we doing? What are the hurdles? What are the risks? I don't say this in jest, but Rick used to joke all the time and say, hey, fake it till you make it. Sometimes you just gotta get out there, and he's like, the best people in the world didn't know how to do what they're doing at some point. So get out there and try it, fail up. I think that's where the fail up thing came from.
You know, I've always believed that failing up is one of our, you know, successful values, that but that it comes naturally. It wasn't a principle that was taught necessarily, but caught by a loving culture around us. We had a thing we used to call the gas night. I don't know if you remember that. It was called the guaranteed applause show. And that happened, we did that once a month usually to create a venue or an opportunity for kids to share their talent, whatever it was. I remember guys, you know, pulling a string through their nose and a cup on the end of it and going like this. They were encouraged to do anything, and that we would love them not just for their ability, but for their gift, but more for who they were. And that's a culture that you create, and that's a culture of innovation. It's a culture of learning. It's a culture of acceptance. And then people just learn to fail up. Okay, try it again. Most things are just a skill. The more you try them, the better you get at it. So go for it, right? So that was the fun culture that God always wanted us to create, and we always had that around us. So,
you know, several times it stuck with me that he would be praying for me, and he said, Trev, like, you know, we just believe for no boundaries. He would always pray, like, no boundaries, man. We walk into what we feel called to, just remember, no boundaries. There's no boundaries in him. That, you know, we need to worry about the possible. Let him take care of the impossible. And he can add the super to our natural. And I just remember being like, wow. All right, let's do this. You know, and it just, man, that stuck with me, that no boundaries is something I claim in prayer all the time, no matter what I'm doing. I'm like, all right, God, don't let me see this with boundaries, with limits. Now let me box this in because this is what makes sense to me.
Rick's always been so passionate about music and the arts. And so Trev was right in his wheelhouse. Like if there was one answer to prayer for Rick and all the sacrifice he made for us and in all the ways he just poured out and never got back for most of us, I feel like Trev was one of the most direct answer to prayers Rick could have ever had. It was crazy. When you look back, I think the reason you get emotional is you realize that none of these people could see this. None of these people could see us actually where we'd go or what we'd live out in our dreams, but it was enough to them to just love you in that moment and trust that God had it. And I think that's why it's emotional, is at the time you don't get it, but now when I'm talking about it, you see how much sacrifice was there.
I've never met a time in history or a young person that was unwelcoming to a gesture of love and respect. You know, depression and suicide in North America is the highest it's ever been and among 14 to 22 year olds. So we're not doing a very good job. A real face-to-face relationship, a real face-to-face handshake means the world to everyone, not just youth. Everyone needs that kind of engagement, that kind of impact and touch. Love unlocks doors. Love is the key to every situation, and we don't understand it. It's a spiritual force that's so powerful. The world was turned upside down by it in Christ's time and can be turned upside down again now if we choose to love and we choose to be love and risk loving.
The reason why we're sharing these stories, you know, and looking back is, you know, not only to honor and celebrate the people who've been loved to us so many times in our life, the Rick Kirshners and, you know, people like my parents and those circumstances in your own life, who those people are who've been loved to you, to turn around and be loved to someone else, you know, in your community, in your church, in your family, the people you walk life with.
So how are we going to use this, or how is God going to use it, or how is this going to help the country? I don't know. I'm not sure yet, but I do believe that we're supposed to do this, that we're called to do this, and that if we can take the time to tell this story and to start this event and to start to serve the people that are making this difference every day in their communities a little better, and give them something that they can rally around and bring their kids to and just be inspired by, I have to believe that somewhere in that God can use this to take the lid off. To take the lid off our country, off our cities, off our regions in a way where we can have 50 Rick Kirshners develop out of this. I remember going to day one at the Pontiac Silver Dome and it rocked me. I thought our youth group was 30 people. I thought that's how many people my age believed in God. And I went to the Pontiac Silver Dome with 60,000 people for day one, and I remember being like, wow, God's cooler than I thought. It seems normal, like I shared in our stories. It seems like it's just our life. But you don't realize that if you've been exposed to that and you're loving the way God tells you to, it becomes extraordinary. We don't take the time to celebrate that or give people a chance, I don't think, to see themselves in it. So they'll see someone like Trev and go, wow, he's just gifted, called. I couldn't do that. But then they hear him sing at 15, go, I could do that. I probably have 5 kids in my youth group who can sing like that. And that's the whole point of it, I think, is to have people see themselves in some of this and realize it's the extraordinary is the love of Jesus. The extraordinary is being willing to actually consistently do that. And we can all do that.